think it's time to get started. I want to first welcome all of you to Conversations on Social Issues. And my name is Kelly McHenry, and this is Kimberly Tate. Today's panel is titled, America's Response to Daesh. And I would like to introduce the speakers on the panel after Kimberly has told you a little bit about COSI.
So go ahead and raise your hand if you've been to a COSI before, right? Okay, so lots of returning faces. I'm so glad to see you, but I noticed we have some new folks in the audience as well. Welcome. The library hosts Conversations on Social Issues every Thursday because we see it as an extension of our charge to promote the freedom of information and open exchange of ideas. And we hope that we're all able to learn from each other's perspectives and experiences, whether or not we necessarily agree with everything that we hear today or any of our sessions. So with that, you'll notice that you have a blank index card. If you don't have that index card, go ahead and raise your hand and we'll get one to you. And so on that card, we're just going to ask you to write down any questions that you might have. After the first part of the panel, we will have some time for audience questions and response from our panel members. So we invite you to remain open-minded and respectful of each other and our presenters. So without further ado, let's go ahead and introduce those who are going to be speaking with us today.
So first I'd like to introduce Dr. Joanne Zouari, and if you could just raise your hand. He is a professor at Seattle Central in political science and Middle East studies. Then sitting here to my right is Khaled Alhamwi. He is a student here at Seattle Central College. Khaled has been attending Seattle Central for 2 years and is interested in pursuing a bachelor's degree in human genetics. Khaled migrated from Syria to flee the war and find a better future in Washington State. Dr. Ali Mian is an assistant professor of Islamic studies at Seattle University, and Dr. Michael Vicente Perez is a faculty member in the Department of Anthropology at the University of Washington. He teaches a class, some of his content is about the anthropology of Muslim societies and Islam. So I am very honored to have these guests here with us today. We have an amazing panel, and I'm excited to hear how what we're gonna learn.
For those who may not be familiar, we're just going to ask our panel members to answer a background question for us. So can you, one by one, if you have something to add, tell us what or who is Daesh? And who are the people who support Daesh? So let's start with Dr. Vicente Perez.
Okay, should I just speak from here or
take this off? Yeah, you can take the microphone off.
I'll try to be brief so that I can give everybody else a chance to say something. But as far as who Daesh is, at least the consensus I've found is that we're talking really about a kind of two sort of organizational, broad organizations kind of coming together. I don't even know if organization is the right way to describe it. But what we're talking about is some sort of grouping of former Baathists from Iraq and other organizations affiliated at one time or another with Al-Qaeda in some ways. And then what we're talking about when we talk about Daesh is really a kind of some sort of unification between these two sort of groups. The debates tend to kind of revolve around what kind of alliance these two groups have, whether or not Baathists are really, for example, Baathists are, this is a secular organization, so the question is whether or not Baathists are really sort of gravitating or adopting a kind of ideology of the other group that has a more sort of Islamic tinge, if that's the right way to describe it, or whether or not there really has been a kind of integration and kind of unified ideology that's emerged between these two groupings. But the discussions around who they are is that we've got really a large grouping of Baathists who used to be part of the Iraqi governmental structure, but that were basically fired, relieved from their duties when the U.S. occupied the country, and left with no employment. And when we get to questions and answers, maybe I can get more specific about this. But these people were displaced from their employment. They were no longer able to function in any capacity that they used to as state actors. And that this sort of vacuum, this space of kind of this displacement of these people from the structures that they used to be a part of, is partially what explains how they start to merge with other actors on the ground. And of course, I have to simplify to some extent. And then the other organization are basically people will talk about, say, Abu Musab Zarqawi from Jordan and other Al-Qaeda sort of affiliate organizations that were already operating within this context of Iraq. And that these two groups have sort of come together and merged to form what we call Daesh. And as an example of this, they'll say that the entire, most if not all of the top tier structure of Daesh is populated by former Iraqi Baathists. Not by, quote, foreign jihadis, and we can talk about those terms, but that this is really the organizational capacity, success, and structure that we see in place in Daesh comes from those who Paul Bremer, under the U.S. occupation, displaced from employment and left them with no place to go, and for various reasons, these people started to get integrated into various organizational networks. But I'll stop there and pass it on to give everybody else a chance to say something.
Something to
yeah,
add to
that was really helpful. I would just say that a simple one-liner would be that there are terrorist groups that purports itself to be a state. But I also want to say something what ISIS or ISIL or Daesh is not. Many people think that they are representatives of Orthodox Islam, and majority of Orthodox Muslim theologians have actually denounced them. And so within religious studies, we distinguish between insider claims and outsider claims.
Could you hold the mic closer?
Yeah. Within religious studies, which is my disciplinary background, we distinguish between insider claims and outsider claims. So as outsiders studying ISIS, you know, they purport themselves to be Muslims, and that's a claim that they make. But there's not a lot of resonance between Orthodox Muslim theology and ISIS's symbols and as well as their discourses.
I'm going to try to link Daesh to what happened in Iraq in 2003, the invasion of Iraq, which was justified by the weapons of mass destruction. Led to the destruction of the structure of the Iraqi state. When you got a state, as was mentioned earlier, then you have to deal with all kinds of problems. So the dismantling of the Ba'ath Party, or what was known as the Ba'athification of Iraq, the destruction of the Iraqi army, which was I think to the Ba'ath Party, that led to a vacuum, and the state building that took place in Iraq under the neoconservative government of George W. Bush tried to kind of reflect the new power structure in Iraq, which means that since the Shia of Iraq were the majority, a little over 60%, they won the elections, the social engineering of Iraq did not really work very well, because the Shia did not have much experience in running a country like Iraq. The Sunnis did, but the Sunnis were a minority, and also you have another minority that is Sunni but not Arab. That's the Kurds, who had ambitions to form a state of their own in the north. So this kind of redesign or rearrangement, if you will, of the state of Iraq led to some serious problems. The prime minister that emerged, Al-Maliki, was handpicked by the United States government, and he was incompetent on one hand. On the other hand, he was extremely sectarian. And therefore his politics, negative approach to the Sunnis, treating them as mostly affiliated with Al-Qaeda, this predates ISIS. And he did not heed the call of the Obama administration to include the Sunnis in the power structure, and that led to ill treatment of the Sunnis. The Sunni minority tried to get some power sharing arrangement, they could not succeed. And then, of course, we have a crackdown on the Sunnis who were involved in the government. They were arrested, some of them escaped. Demonstrations, peaceful demonstrations by the Sunnis, huge camps, led to the intervention of the police and the army and the massacre of innocent people. And at the same time, we have Syria. Syria was facing incredible challenges after the beginning of the Arab Spring and from Tunisia and spreading to Egypt with the amendment in Syria. And that's we have the beginning of the elements of, or remnants of Al-Qaeda who were looking for a place in Syria, provided a very good place to refuge, to fight for their cause. And of course, I'm not going to get into the details about their ideology, interpretation of Islam, etc. For now, but when they saw the treatment of the Sunnis, because ISIS is Sunni, in Iraq, they just raced right back into Iraq. And of course, the Sunnis were very, Sunni minority were, did not like ISIS, but they were receptive because they were being basically massacred by the Shia. So this is the context of the emergence of ISIS. So there's elements of American intervention. The state building that took place in Iraq was faulty. Sectarian behavior by the Shia, vindictive, distrustful of the Sunnis. And of course, this was mentioned, what makes ISIS deadly is its fanaticism and methods, but also what makes them expansive and ambitious to build a state in the Sham or the Iraq and Syria. Is that they have the expertise of those that the United States sidelines, namely the former army officers, the Iraqi army, the Sunnis, and also the former Baathists. So that's what gives them planning, that what gives them the ability to conquer territory, hold it before they have the ability, and also to be very strategic and to, you know, now they are, their ambitions to build a state or a caliphate, which means that they extract taxes. All these things are due to the you know, the structure they inherited or that joined them. And that's the Baathists and the Iraqi army, so of course not there.
So continuing to paint the background picture, and you may want to comment more on the last question, but the next question might also be interesting to you. That is, who is being most affected by Daesh?
Sure.
Thanks for coming over today, for everyone. And, I'll try to say my best. You see, I don't have any paper, I don't have any pen. I think the memory is the best way to explain what you get from there, I mean, what the situation, what kind of situation or what kind of crisis is going on there, and there is Zouari. Actually, I left Syria when I was 17 to some Gulf country. You know, 17 years, I don't know anything. I don't know what this country is fighting for and what this country is fighting for. What the purpose of USA, the purpose of Russia, the purpose of Iran, Israel, or somebody else, I don't know, you know. It's like I don't have the mind, or I'm not on that level yet to know what people, what countries, what billions of donors and military strategies and all those things. I can't know what their purposes are. The only thing, recently, like the last 2 years, I started reviewing what's going on in the area. I found like media every 3 years emphasize on some group with her in some country. We have seen Taliban in Afghanistan, media focused on them like for 3 years. Then when Al-Qaeda started, media focused on them for 3 years. Then Hezbollah in Lebanon for 3 years. Then today is ISIS. So I really don't know why. It's like why every 3 years we have a new group and we have new strategy and new plans for those, like as reaction for those. It's kind of, I'm not politics expert, I mean, but it's really so interesting for me, like why every couple of years we have new groups with new ideology, a new area, and with new some circumstances. Also, like she was asking me, for sure Syrian people in there, or the Levant area in general, are the most affected in ISIS, because those people in that area have no ideology related to ISIS ideology. You know, they call this area the cradle of civilization, since Christianity or Judaism start from there, or even before, it's like before the Roman and the Greek Empire, Assyrians, Sumeric Empire also, like 8 or 7 thousand, I'm not sure. It's probably more than 4,000 years ago. So, I mean, people in there, they know what to do, they know what they have, and they know what their history is. So, I mean, they don't have any kind of this ideology. I mean, also, I would say, like, nobody, I mean, I don't like to talk about those politic things, because I, like, everybody has his point of view, and we don't know the truth yet. I'm saying just, I think, in my opinion, just international, or let's say, nations war, like big powers war, it has no relationship with people in there. I mean, yeah, that's what I can say. Also, I would like to say, like, due to ISIS right now, or Syrian regime, or some other groups also, we can see all of them are fighting each other. And like around 12 million people in there are fleeing the country. This is, I think the number is much more bigger than this, but media still have the statistics today. So, I mean, we should, like, people forgot talking about this crisis, like people and civilians, and they just are still talking about ISIS and the conflict in them, and the weapons and all. So, and that's why I'm here to just give this message, and hopefully I was clear, I mean, and that's why I'm here. Thank you very much.
By Daesh, I think one thing to start with is to say who isn't affected by Daesh. And I think that I would say the United States is very thinly affected by Daesh if we take it within the borders of this country. Apparently since September 11th, we use that as our sort of starting point till now, a total of about 38 people have been killed with some loose relationship to this thing called Daesh. Now, you compare that to say the 400,000 people have been killed by gun violence since September 11th until now. And it tells us that Daesh is really a very thin threat to anything here domestically within the United States. That's not to diminish the importance of people dying in San Bernardino or whatever. Of course, that event in and of itself is not clear the extent to which that really has anything to do with Daesh. But there's this tendency, I think, to overblow the idea that Daesh really presents some sort of existential threat in this country. It simply doesn't. Now, where it does present, I think, a threat is within the region itself. And I think what's also interesting is that the interest in Daesh and its threat capacity, if you want to call it that, tends to ignore the fact that Daesh is not the lone actor in the region, and it's not the only actor that's causing the instability of what we're seeing in the region. So for example, we should be as concerned with Bashar Assad's regime and the actions of that government towards and its impact on the people within the region. I was in Jordan last summer. I hope to go again this coming summer, and I hope to continue doing research there. And I can tell you that Jordan is affected in a way far more important than anything we could think about the effect of the United States. They have an incredible number of refugees. Refugees are having so bad that in fact they're, after living several years in the camps, they're actually taking the chance of crossing through Syria one more time to try to get out of Jordan to get to Europe, because there's no future for them in a place like Jordan. And in addition to that, the refugees who are arriving in Jordan are learning from the Palestinian refugees who have been there since 1948 and seeing that this temporary condition of refugees is often a very long-term one that's not temporary at all, so people are leaving. So we should be thinking about, I mean, it affects the region, and I use the region broadly, but I would think it affects Syria, Iraq, Jordan, Lebanon, Turkey. You know, these are the places where I think Daesh matters perhaps most. It does not matter as much here, even though we tend to have this sense of insecurity as a result of Daesh's presence. But I think we should always, you know, look at the numbers to some degree to see the extent to which this really does present a threat. I would say Daesh is really a problem for the region, and it's not the only problem for the region. And we should not treat it as if it's the only problem for the region. We should treat it as part of a larger kind of constellation of issues that needs to be resolved if you're going to get some sort of solution. So in other words, if Daesh were to disappear tomorrow, I do not think that that would mean that the region all of a sudden would fall into some sort of stable condition. Absolutely not, and that's the wrong way to see it if you ask me.
Yes, in addition to that, I would add that countless American Muslims are affected by the media coverage of Daesh and ISIL and ISIS. And American Muslims have to basically, we find ourselves in a position as if we have to apologize for the formation and for the actions of Daesh and ISIS. And so the predicament that the media coverage, the overblown media coverage of ISIS puts us in is I think, it presupposes and it demands the assuming of collective guilt and responsibility, and that itself is a strategy of minoritization. That is one way that Muslims are othered and minoritized in this country. And so some of the effects of the media coverage are symbolic, and they're also psychological. And so how is the Muslim youth reacting to and basically processing the equivalence found in the American media between Islam and ISIS? And I think that's a very, not just a wrong equivalence, but also a very dangerous equivalence, politically speaking.
I would say that those who are most affected by ISIS are the Muslims. The West is not affected at all. Or very little. The threat of ISIS is used in the West for political reasons, because when we look at the numbers, we find that almost all the attacks by ISIS are in Muslim countries, whether they are, by strong, well-organized, militarized groups, or by individuals, what we call here the lone wolves. In the West, most of the attacks have been from individuals who were loosely connected to ISIS. For example, the San Bernardino connection is based on an email that proved to be outdated or not really connected. So aside from that, the Muslim countries are badly affected by the activities of ISIS. And then I'm talking about states, or you mentioned Syria, Iraq are the main states. But now we see that because of the pressure and the bombings from from the United States, Russia, and other Europeans in the coalition to fight ISIS. ISIS is kind of the diversifying and trying to look for other shells. And there is a shell of a state that's Libya. It's trying to get its act together, and ISIS now is moving to Libya. It's trying to establish itself. It has a couple of cities under its control. It has also sources of survival. They have attacked the oil installations, which led now to Western countries moving into Libya. And that has led to a lot of criticism from observers as well as the people in Libya. England, for example, spent about $20 million on reconstruction of Libya after the NATO operation during 2011, but about $300 million, more than $300 million on the destruction of Libya. So we see that there's an imbalance in terms of what the deeds and the intention of Europeans are in Libya. So now we see the United States, we see Britain, we see France and Italy who are in Libya on the ground, about over 6,000 highly specialized troops to guard the oil installations, not to help solve the problems in Libya. Those who are really concerned about the stability of Libya are the neighboring countries like Tunisia, Algeria, Egypt, and a lot of the meetings, political meetings are happening in Rabat, and Algiers, and Tunis, and Cairo. The other affected people that I want to mention is the families. Because ISIS is a very sophisticated terrorist group, and it uses sophisticated propaganda, images, things that appeal to young people who are confused or searching for some meaning for their lives. In places like Tunisia, which contributes the largest contingent of fighters for ISIS. Now, Tunisia is the only country that has succeeded in the Arab Spring, but there's a contradiction. It's also the country that has the largest contingent. And it's the second country, which is understandable, Saudi Arabia, Wahhabism and fanaticism, but Tunisia is a secular state. It has a strong Islamist party which opened the door to preaching from the Wahhabis and from Qatar and from Saudi Arabia to come in. And for the period between 2011 and 2014, Tunisian kids were attracted to ISIS. So their families are affected. These are middle class Tunisian families who are Muslim, but we can't say they're secular, we cannot say they're religious, they're just normal Muslim people who some pray, some don't pray, and they take care of their families, and some of their kids who are 19, 20 are going to join ISIS without them knowing. There are some pleas by the parents on YouTube asking people to help them find their kids or ask the government to find a way. Also some who are returning, the ISIS fighters who are returning to places like Tunisia and to Europe, what do we do with them? We put them in jail, we let them loose. In Tunisia, for example, some of them were let loose and they committed terrorist acts in the Bible Museum in March in the beaches of my hometown and killed about 30 British tourists. How do we defend against that?
Thank you so much. So we're going to move on to our next question. So it's been mentioned a couple times that the West, or the United States in particular, is not in any way, shape, or form the most affected group of people by ISIS's actions. So, but is there anything that the United States can do, appropriate military, diplomatic strategies that won't exacerbate the problem, but instead could actually help to solve this problem?
I'm not a policy analyst, but I would say that what we should do is look at to see what has been done and the extent to which that succeeded at all. And it seems to me that the success is not within view. We've bombed, I don't know, how many thousands of bombs we've dropped since we started bombing in June of 2014. I don't know how many bombs we've dropped over there, but it's in the thousands. We get contradictory results, and for example, on one hand we say the government issues numbers that up to 15,000 Daesh people have been killed, yet the organization by the CIA is said to have only 30,000 people, somewhere between 20 and 30,000. If that's the case, our bombing campaign would have been incredibly successful because it would have killed so many of them that there would have been a very diminished capacity, but clearly that's not the case. So the numbers, the success of bombing is clearly inflated. The US does not track the number of civilians that it kills in the process in addition, so we have that problem. We don't even know who's being killed by these bombings. So it seems to me that what we have seen happen over the course of the last few years has not worked. If by worked we mean that Daesh has been somehow diminished in its capacity, on the run, or has been expelled from particular territories. And in fact, my understanding is that the most successful dislodging of Daesh has happened because of the Kurdish organizations, Iraqi organizations, or military capacity, not by U.S. bombing campaigns. So it seems to me that if there's one thing that I would suggest the U.S. do, it would be to stop bombing. I think the most important thing that the U.S. could do, if it is going to bomb, is to bomb the economic capacity of Daesh. That seems to be the most important area to focus on, which is how it is that the economy that Daesh depends on is succeeding. And part of that economy seems to come from oil. And so what people have been suggesting in the policy analysis that I've read is that what should be focused on is how to cut the funding sources off from Daesh, to diminish its economy. Because people, for example, The National had an article not too long ago in which it interviewed various fighters for Daesh who had defected, and these people said that they were mostly motivated for economic reasons. So if you're a Daesh fighter, for example, you do get a stipend. You do get a monthly stipend. And so what really needs to happen is some concerted effort by these coalitions that we talk about that's focusing on Daesh, and see in what ways the funding for this institution can be checked so that it diminishes its ability to do what it has been doing successfully as a kind of quasi-state institution. Now I'll let the rest focus on other things that might work.
Well, what I can say is that what the United States has not done, the United States has not engaged in rebuilding the countries that attract groups like ISIS, because ISIS that cannot operate in states that are functioning. ISIS looks for states that are failing, namely Syria, Iraq, Libya. They're moving into Afghanistan. So they look for shells, and if we deny them that structure, then that is the solution. So we, the United States, need to look at the root cause of that leads to the emergence of these groups, and then help those countries that are affected by ISIS to find a way to rebuild their structure. So Syria is a bit complicated because conflict has been internationalized, so the United States is against the regime of Bashar al-Assad staying in power. Russia now is back into global politics, supporting Bashar al-Assad's regime, and we have other regional players such as Saudi Arabia and others that are not known. So if the United States were to be serious about addressing this problem, in addition to the military approach, denying this and that, economic access to economic means for ISIS, those are technical things. But I believe that an exclusive military solution will fail. It not work. And it looks like in the United States we tend to be attracted by easy, simplistic military solutions. We hear, for example, the conservative candidates talking about carpet bombing, talking about killing all of ISIS, taking their oil, all this stuff. This just makes absolutely no sense. So there need to be a combination, use of force, denying territory, denying means of survival, etc. But at the same time, it has to be accompanied with a plan to help these countries get back on their feet. Libya, for example, is going to, you know, become another place for ISIS because very little is being done to help the Libyans rebuild, to help the Libyans sit down and talk to each other. When Libya has two governments, Libya is structurally or institutionally doesn't even have half a government, but now it has two. It doesn't have a national army, so we need to think about helping them rebuild their army and stop from pushing our economic and strategic interests the way we are doing it. We can do that, but also we have to take into account the stability and the survival of those countries.
Thank you. I'm going to ask Sam now to collect question cards, and while he's collecting them, I would like to bring the discussion to the conversation going on mainly among Republican candidates for president about Syrian refugees coming to the United States. And some people will say we should keep them out. There are millions of people who have been forced to flee Syria, and they are mainly going into Europe. But what should America's response be to helping the Syrian refugees?
And I'll add to that, that if you had something that you wanted to say for the previous question, that would also be an appropriate time.
I think this is sort of a segue between the previous question and the question about Syrian immigrants and refugees. I think at the level of public discourse, and also at the level of governmental action, a change of mentality and perspective is something that we could also do. That we, in the US, the government especially has to acknowledge that it is complicit. It is complicit in the formation of ISIS and the appearance of Syrian refugees on the doors of Europe and on the shores of Europe and on the shores of the US. The dominant political order of the modern West is in many different ways complicit in this huge political problem. So yes, there are local causes and there are ideological causes, there are economic and socioeconomic causes rooted in Iraq and Syria, but no one's hands in the US, for example, the US government is complicit in this emergence. So that's a change in mentality that this is something that was caused elsewhere and it's now haunting us, that has to change. We are complicit in its production and in its proliferation.
Maybe Khaled would like to say something about this.
First of all, actually, I'm really sad. I'm really sad to see and see every day. I mean, just imagine if your country is just getting destroyed in front of your eyes every day. Country with 6,000 or 8,000 years. I mean, there's really something to think about. Like, why this is happening every day? You just ask yourself, why Syria, not somewhere else? I mean, I don't mean to wish this for any country at all because it's really hard. And it's sad also, I feel sad for Syrian people. I mean, Syrian people are very educated people. I know who they are, I know who we are, I mean. We got very good education. We like to depend on ourselves. We don't like to depend on everybody. We like to improve ourselves. I mean, we used to produce everything by ourselves, not depending even on government. Like if you go to that area, we have factories for everything. We have cars factories, we have medicine. I mean, just people used to come from East Europe to Syria just to get, just to go to hospitals or medication, I mean. So I feel really sad that we are losing all those things for like unknown future, I mean. And it's getting, every day, day after day, it's getting worse for like unknown future. I mean, I can't tell anything. I mean, if like big countries cannot know what would happen, I can't, it's impossible for me to know anymore. I would like to say also people are very, very hardworking people, so they're really, I think, and I'm sure about this, they are really a good ad for every country they go to. And this is happening today in Germany, when German Prime Minister said, we are welcoming people who will be like good ads for our economy, German economy. And that's what's happening today. It's like very young guys from 17 to 25, they go to factories, they go to universities, and of course, they will be like what Angela Merkel said, the Prime Minister in Germany. And I hope like many countries take the same steps like what Germany did, because I think until today they did the best, like on topic of Syrian refugees or dealing with Syrian refugees and giving them opportunities. Thank you very much.
I guess briefly to the refugee question, I would just add, let's not forget refugees have rights. And it's not about American values that are at stake here. It's about whether we are going to fundamentally deny or accept people's rights to flee a country that they have a well-founded fear of persecution from, to seek shelter with another country, and to either be resettled there or to be resettled in a third country. Those are three rights refugees have. You don't get to negate those rights on the assumption, faulty as it is, that some Syrians may be members of Daesh and want to cause harm. That's not how human rights work. That's not how refugee rights work. So we really, when the Republicans are having this discussion, they're at odds with the entire international infrastructure built to protect people who flee their country. I would also add that we bear a particular responsibility, given that it was our fault that Iraq fell to pieces. So it makes no sense at all for us to sit here and talk about whether our values are at stake or whether we should be accepting refugees, as if we're disconnected from the very phenomenon of displacement that we've been seeing. We helped destroy Iraq. We haven't helped rebuild it. And therefore, we have a particular responsibility to aid Syrians in this particular time of crisis. And what's also interesting is that we shouldn't forget the fact that Syrians have been coming to this country for decades, and they have been putting some of the greatest intellectual minds in this country. I mean, I know, I lived in Michigan, and I can tell you that there were so many doctors and professionals. This isn't to discredit people who are not professionals, but it's to say that a lot of intellectual drain happened from Syria, and this country has benefited from having those people here. It's really hypocritical now to try to sort of distance ourselves from our responsibility for those displacements, and then to start to say, to question the status of whether a refugee deserves to be here or not. I think the entire conversation is really misguided, and we really need to remember that it's the rights that refugees have, not the values of this country, that come first.
Thank you so much. Time, we want to start moving to some of the audience questions, and if you feel comfortable answering these questions, then feel free to just grab the mic. So the first is, why don't Arab countries do more to help settle conflicts in the Middle East, and what can they do? They have more land, money, and a better understanding of what's going on. It seems as though the U.S., Russia, and Western countries are doing something. It's not a simple question. I'm just reading the cards.
Well, this is a misconception that the West is trying to solve these conflicts in the Middle East. The other countries are also in the region are playing a big role in trying to solve the problem. Sometimes they take the wrong approach, but I mentioned the case of Libya. Not considered to be a failing state, and Daesh is, increasing its power there. We know that the neighboring countries, namely Tunisia and even further to the west, Morocco and Egypt, are playing a big role. Some of the opposition leaders of Libya are in places like Tunisia and Egypt, and they are negotiating, sitting around the table and trying to find a solution. We don't see that happening in the West. The West, the intervention in Libya has been military, in Syria it's military. So the countries in the region are not doing as much as they should, but some of them are doing more than they can, you know, they're capable of doing. So it's not as simple as what we might feel in the West, that we are doing everything, they're doing nothing. In fact, to go back to the issue of refugees, the West takes close to zero refugees. Even refugees that the West creates, like the United States, has displaced millions of people in Afghanistan, Iraq, and Syria. And 98% not end up in the West. The West takes less than 2%. The rest, they all go to the neighboring country. We displaced millions of people in Afghanistan, they ended up in Iran and Pakistan. The people who displaced in Syria, they're in Jordan. They make up now a huge section of the population of Lebanon. Some say that it's about one third of the population of Lebanon. So the rest, the countries of the region are doing a lot. And some of them are doing more than they can handle, especially with regard to the refugees.
Actually, I can't say that surrounding countries in there are not helping, because I mean, I saw statistics and I went to all those countries. I went to Turkey, I went to many Gulf countries, to Egypt also. So I know the population of Syrians in there. Some of them went to their families. We used to be there before the crisis, I mean. And some of them, like thousands of, I mean, hundreds of thousands, they just went there, and I saw that in my eye. I saw this in my eyes, I mean. So, and I have connection to many Syrians in there. And they tell, like, in some places, they start making minorities, like, this new districts, new businesses. New. So, I mean, I can't say that surrounding countries are not helping. But, you know, the mainstream media, it's like Europe or USA, they have more coverage on people who are going to their countries. So of course, I mean, nobody watch like Middle East media, of course. So that's why nobody is being informed that whether how many people are in here or how many people are here. It's just media coverage. It depends, and it depends on what kind of media people watch. And one more thing also, of course, when you get the chance to choose, you'll show the best opportunity for you. It's like for me, they told me like choose one country, I would choose Europe, of course, because I will have better opportunity. I mean, yeah. So that's why. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So we just remembered just a bit, but we have another question about what can the independent local media sources do to fight against Islamophobia.
Well, the media sources, I guess, talk to actual Muslims, you know, go to the local mosque, make sure that you cover different perspectives within the Muslim community, but and avoid generalizations. I have before me a report that just came out from the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill, and this is not for media coverage, but it's basically for local police and local law enforcement agencies. And these are their recommendations, and they're long, so I'll read some of them. Establish outreach and engagement units within departments to the greater extent budgets can support. Do not use the phrase countering violent extremism. So don't ask local Muslims Can you give us tips on how to encounter violent extremists and then assume that the same extremists go to the mosque? Prioritize addressing public safety and other concerns of the community. Conduct outreach and engagement with all communities and sub-communities in a jurisdiction. So do not single out Muslims. Separate outreach and engagement units from intelligence collection and criminal investigatory units. And recruit and hire a workforce that reflects the racial, ethnic, and religious composition of a community. So local media could actually hire a Muslim as, like, you know, the person who covers these events and talks to members of the Muslim community. One of the recommendations made here is that do not just interview and do not just reach out to Muslim men, but reach out to Muslim women as well. So they should also read like an introduction to Islam. You know, what I would recommend Carol Hillenbrand's book called Introduction to Islam, or read something by Karl Ernst, for example, Following Muhammad in the Contemporary World. So there are many resources that the local media can tap into.
I don't know that I would add anything really more to that. I think the inclusion of Muslims into more public forums within the city would be a great thing to do. I think that more people know Muslims and talk to Muslims, the better. And I do think the city should take on a kind of active campaign against Islamophobia and recognize it as a real problem within the city. I think that would be a really helpful thing to make explicit a discussion about Islamophobia as city policy here within Seattle, instead of keeping it a kind of national abstract discussion. We should be trying to find ways to figure out what Muslims' experiences of discrimination are, where those happen, and what might be done to solve those problems. For example, the city has the Race and Social Justice Initiative, which is meant to sort of desegregate the hiring practices of the city. Are Muslims included in that? Is the Muslim community considered part of the Race and Social Justice Initiative? If it is, how? If not, why? So the city can be more proactive. And I don't want to take away from some efforts. I mean, it was just an op-ed, but I do want to recognize that our governor did stand up in the midst of the anti-Syrian refugee discourse and said that we should admit Syrians. So it's good to see that in Washington State, maybe there is a slightly more fertile ground for this, but I think we could do more. And I think it requires understanding what Islamophobia is, how people experience it locally, and locally with Muslims working on this, how do we combat it in a more effective way?
Thank you.
Well, I would add one thing. I believe that it is important for the city, for the state, for the country to have a proactive approach to combat Islamophobia, to have the Muslim community, which is the majority of peaceful people and are very productive. In fact, there was the report in Time magazine about Arab Americans who are above average in everything, in education and income in the United States. They're a very successful minority in contrast to Muslim Europeans. Muslim Europeans are ghettoized in France and Paris and other places. What I would add is that Muslims themselves, American Muslims, need to take an active role in participation. They need to participate, they need to organize. Respect is not given, respect is earned. And they need to look at what other minorities have done to earn respect, and they need to model, they need to learn from them, they need to look at the civil rights movements. African Americans were not given rights, they took them, they actually sacrificed, they battled. And I think for Muslims to earn their place in the American society, they should take the opportunities given to them, but those opportunities are not as effective as the ones they're going to take. They need to participate, organize, and be more politically engaged.
Thank you. Thank you so much. We don't have time to get through all of these questions, so I will ask one more of our questions, and if our speakers have time after the panel, feel free to approach them and say, hi, do you have time to talk to me first? And if not, thank you for your participation. And if you do, go ahead and ask your question. So I will leave you with this, and you touched on it just a little bit. What similarities do you see between the labeling of African-American and Latino youth as gang-related for associating, socializing, or sharing life worlds or worldviews, and the labeling of Muslim youth as Al-Qaeda or extremist-associated, and what dangers do you imagine can result over the long term that we should be concerned about as a result of this labeling, given all that we know?
To be brief and try to give everybody time, I guess the assumption of suspicion, the presumption of guilt, rather, is probably one of the most common threads between the discrimination of Black Americans, Latino Americans, and now Muslim Americans. I think it's a very terrible thing when you presume an entire group of people bear a responsibility to prove that they're not something, that they're not even responsible for in the first place, because the stereotype that has stigmatized them that way was not of their own doing to begin with. So I think, you know, where we see a real common intersection here is in the way that there's a suspicion, a sort of legitimized suspicion around Muslims. I mean, the public discourse surrounding Muslims right now is appalling, and it's licensed by the assumption that Muslims are given to radicalization, or it's somehow within our faith that these terrible things come from. And it's not, it's not unlike the assumptions that we've seen in the past, in which racist ideology was used to say that, well, Blacks are given to act this kind of way, or because they're Black, or Latinos are given to act this way because they're Latinos. Well, now it's Muslims are given to act because of Islam, as almost this kind of decentralizing thing. And I think Sam Harris, who was parroted by Omar, calling Islam the motherlode of bad ideas, is a very good indication of the way that people are creating a kind of essential sense of Islam that then is used and applied to Muslims unjustly, and that puts on us a burden to try to prove that we're not something that the media has helped stigmatize us by. So there's where I see a very common thread. Of course, there are various other more practical ways we can look at this. I mean, there, the U.S. is engagement in counterterrorism projects throughout the country, and these have histories that relate and intersect with other programs the governments have done to try to infiltrate Black communities, etc. So, there are lots of ways that these things are intersecting, but at the most general level, I think it's at the sort of level of discussion of discourse and the way that we've legitimized the discussion about Muslims in ways that resembles very much the racist discussions about Latinos and Africans.
All right, it seems maybe we have time for one more question. Okay, so let's see. So, what is the most important role that education can play in this discussion, this issue? And I'll add, are there any resources you'd like to recommend for folks to learn more and educate themselves? Learn more about Islam, about discussions around Islam and being cognizant of biases that might be at play, or just anything that you just think people should read that is in your film and relates to this discussion.
Well, there's a lot of good books, but they're all outnumbered by manifold bad books and reckless coverage in the internet, but also on social media and in print culture. So. The books are so many, it's hard. I think many people are hailing the new publication by HarperCollins of the Study Quran as some of the editors hope that it would provide an antidote to some of the negative sort of discursive and conceptual misunderstandings that surround Islam. So that's one resource, the Study Quran. There are countless books, there's I just mentioned Introduction to Islam by Carol Hillenbrand, and there's so many other books. There's a book called Who is Allah by Bruce Lawrence. There's a book called What is a Madrasa by Ibrahim Musa, and many of these books are published by UNC Press. So one could also go to the local mosque and ask for literature. It's a hard question. Like, education has a fundamental role to play in that, you know.
Well, I think education is the most important tool to dispel some of the myths about whether it's about African Americans or whether it's about Hispanics or Muslims. Because usually the demagogues who use generalizations and stereotypes, they count on people's ignorance. If we were knowledgeable about the other, we wouldn't be easily manipulated by demagogues like Trump or whoever is talking about others. My approach is, instead of giving title of books or who is the best author, I ask people when they ask me these questions, in addition to giving them a short list, is to ask who is talking about whom. Now, when you watch some of the American media outlets, and there is a discussion about ISIS, if the expert talking about Muslims is from Israel, you need to take a huge grain of salt, because they're not going to be unbiased. They don't do. Someone who is not Muslim is going to talk about Islam, doesn't mean that they cannot be knowledgeable. They are a scholar. But if they are a politician talking about Islam, I don't think they're going to be very helpful. So we need to ask who is saying what about whom. Look at the background of the person. You also have to be very discriminating in terms of your choices of the media, the source itself. So you're not going to get a balanced image of Muslims or the issue of terrorism on Fox News. That's a given. And this is if you didn't know what Fox News is. You have to basically pay attention to who is on the, being asked questions, how they are asking it, what they are not asking, because you can manipulate the subject in so many ways. We focus, for example, talking about Muslims, about conflict, about killings, about violence, but no one is discussing, what the fundamental tenets of Islam are, not in the media. And even the Christians who say, Jesus loves you, come and join us, they don't know what's in the Quran. The Quran cites Jesus like 24 times and Muhammad only twice. So they haven't read the Quran. They don't know that there's a whole chapter on Mary, for example, in the Quran. So there is a lot in common that they ignore. And they look at as if Islam has monopoly on oppressing women. Well, if you read the Bible, it doesn't speak highly of women. And if you look at history, Christian women did not get any rights until more than 1,000 years after Muslim women had all those rights, like inheritance, education, and those things. So. Need to pay attention to who's saying what about whom and how they're saying it, and ask yourselves questions. Your librarian is probably the best source. Librarians are very, balanced people, and they can give you some sources. Also, try to look at the sources from the people who are from the culture, as opposed to looking at someone who talked about the culture. Some of the scholars in the United States and Europe who talk about Islam, who talk about Arabs, they don't speak Arabic. I'll give you an example. In 1979, when the Iranian Revolution was taking place, the greatest revolution of the 20th century, we sent more than 300 journalists to Tehran. None of them spoke Persian. Can they report accurately about what's happening? This is the greatest revolution of the 20th century. We sent 300 people who don't speak damn word of Persian. And we listened to them, we said the death of America. Thank you.
But in terms of the studies of Islamophobia, I'd like to add that some of the best studies of how Islamophobia operates as a phenomenon and as a discourse and as a as something that stigmatizes Muslims has been done by non-Muslim scholars of American Islam. So I would recommend just two books, Carl Burns, The Anatomy of Islamophobia, and then there's a book by Peter Gottschalk on Islamophobia. And so both of these scholars are contributing positively to the study of American Islam.
I would just quickly add a couple sites. Religion Dispatches is a good public blog run by the University of Southern California, and it has it's a very interfaith and website that Muslims talk on, Christians, atheists, very religion focused. I would say, you know, pay attention to what Muslims themselves are publishing. The Islamic Monthly, Alt-Muslim, Alt-Muslima. These are all sources where you get to see what conversations Muslims are having about these things. You know, there's always a sense that, well, Muslims aren't doing enough. And it's always, I always answer, well, are you even informed about what they are doing to say that they're not doing something? You know, because I look at Muslims having incredibly dynamic conversations all the time and trying to figure out what are the best ways to deal with these problems that affect our communities. Of course, if you don't know about these efforts, then it's easy to say we're not doing anything, but that's not actually quite accurate. So sites like Alt-Muslima are very, you know, which have a very critical gender angle for those interested in gender, are really resourceful, and those have been growing over the several years. So go to these sites and see what conversations Muslims are having themselves in the United States about these issues. And I think that's one good way to start.
Thank you so much. I just want to take this time for everyone to thank our panelists for their time and expertise. We really appreciate you coming out and staying the entire time. Again, if our panelists have any time afterwards, then you're welcome to try to approach them and ask them any questions that I didn't get to. But have a wonderful, wonderful day. Thank you.